Welcome. Welcome to Fairleigh Dickinson University. It's great seeing some familiar faces here tonight. My name is Timur Pakai. I am the new executive director of the Rothman Institute of Innovation and Entrepreneurship here at FDU. It's my pleasure to welcome you to tonight's event. The Institute is part of the Silverman College of Business, whose mission is to support and teach innovation and entrepreneurship in the academic, business, and nonprofit community. I want to thank Campus Provost Peter Woolley for being here tonight, as well as the Morris Tech meetup organizers for supporting our event and inviting a really dynamic entrepreneur, Anthony Frazier, to share his experience with you. Tonight we honor FDU alumnus Gene Waddy for his unparalleled accomplishments as an entrepreneur and his courageous generosity as a humanitarian. This lecture would not have been possible without the endowment of Richard M. Clarke, a global entrepreneur and a man dedicated to the progress and innovation of this university. With a career in chemicals and plastics spanning three decades, Mr. Clarke served as chairman of Yankelovich Partners before moving on to Axo America. He served as a board of trustee here at the university from 1988 through 1998 before making his way to becoming a member of President Adams' advisory cabinet. Through these lecture series, he envisioned entrepreneurs sharing their insurmountable love for innovative thinking, leadership, determination, and willingness to take risks with the next generation of entrepreneurs. The Rothman Institute thanks him for endowing this lecture series. So without further ado, kicking off this event introducing our first speaker, I'd like to call up John Carini, who is a serial entrepreneur and one of the organizers of Meetup. Thank you.
Thanks, Timur. Usually I trip on my way up, but this time I'm okay. So as I hope you all know, the Morris Tech Meetup meets here at FDU, and we're doing this event together with FDU today. So if you don't know about it, it's meetup.com/Morris Tech, right? So check it out. Our next event is actually October 21st, right? And we have Bob Dorf, who is really a well-renowned entrepreneurial author speaking at that event. And that is here at FDU in the Orangery, which is basically the library right across the lawn right here. So we'd love to see you there. Those events are, we typically don't charge, but we're starting to charge just a little bit for these events, so it's a really good value if you decide to come. Anyway, we have some great speakers. We meet every month, and that's all because of FDU. They provide the space and a lot of publicity for us to enable us to have these fantastic events. So some of my other organizers are here. We have Elizabeth Gerhardt right here, who helps us run the meetup, and Pavita Howe, who couldn't be here tonight, also helps quite a bit, and Mark Baskin, who will actually come up, and I'm not introducing the next speaker, but Mark is. So thanks, FDU, for co-hosting, and Mark, go ahead and tell us. I never give him a microphone that works. That's really smart. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I'm excited to hear all the content in this program tonight. When I heard that we were co-hosting a distinguished entrepreneurial lecture series, I immediately thought of the next speaker, Anthony Frazier. And I've gotten to know Anthony a little bit over the last couple of years. We run the Morris Tech Meetup. He is involved with Brick City Tech Meetup, and I'm aware of that. And when you get to know him more and more, His story is amazing, and I'm really excited to hear it. Just real quick, he is, I don't know about most known because of the great city, but from one of the tech entrepreneurial guys that are running this, from that. But before that, he started a media company, back startup. He's doing a conference that's amazing, tech APOA conference. He's doing all this great stuff. And the New Jersey entrepreneurial and tech community is a lot better for his contribution to it. So with that, I want to introduce Anthony Brazier.
So great in school that I can go to a good college. Unfortunately, all I did was cut school to go play Tecmo Bowl, video games, all types of stuff, Madden, Street Fighter. You know, I don't know of any young people in here, but that's what I was playing. And cutting class every day. So that was what I was doing every single day until it became a point where I couldn't actually go to a legit university. By the time it was time for us to graduate high school, I was so excited. I was going to my guidance counselor. I was like, yeah, I want to go to NYU, go to film school. He was like, well, you ain't got the grades to go to film school, man. And so I ended up actually going to Essex County College in Newark, New Jersey. The plan was to go to Essex County College and then transfer over to NYU. Now, as an entrepreneur, plans go left, right? So that was the plan. It didn't quite end that way. I actually dropped out of Essex County College. And this is no diss to the school, but I felt depressed. You know, Essex County College is one of the only places I've been that has classrooms with no windows. So I felt like I was in prison a little bit. I was like, man, this is like the 13th grade. I'm out of here. And so I ended up basically working at Kmart because I couldn't get a legit job because of that. But I was still this big gamer. You know, I love video games so much. I love playing them. I love, you know, talking about them. It turns out there was a group of kids who were same age as me that was on a video game forum, and they love playing games too. And they started talking about them. And then we started talking about them together. And then all of a sudden, on this website, we started bringing this web message forum so much traffic that we were the number one reason why he was like ranking so high in Google. And then we didn't know each other. We were all on different places. They, you know, some people were based in the UK, some people were based in Houston. So we all got on Skype one day and we just thought, what if we made our own site? What if we just drove traffic to our own site? Maybe we can, you know, outdo where we were just at. And that's exactly what we did. We started a site called thecoalition.com. It was a gaming site, and we wanted to focus specifically on African Americans because we felt like that was missing in the market. You know, usually when you hear about gamers, you hear about someone, you know, usually super overweight, in the basement, cheese doodles on a controller, things like that. That was the narrative when you thought about video games, but that wasn't how I grew up. Like, that wasn't, you know, my uncle, he introduced me to Zelda and Tecmo Bowl, and I was like, what about my story? What about our story, right? And so we created this site, and I would say about a year later, this is around in 2008, about a year later, we were averaging about 300,000 uniques a month. And so we saw that the market responded very well to us, you know, appealing to African-American gamers. And so the site did so well, and we started earning money off of advertising. We did some exclusive deals. We started working alongside developers, but it wasn't paying the bills. You know, we had about six writers, six people I started that project with, and I was still working at Kmart. You know, so I was like, man, like, this isn't gonna pay the bills. And I saw a magazine cover with Mark Zuckerberg. Now, at this time, Facebook was only about 4 years old. So this isn't the Facebook we know today. This is about 2008 Facebook. And I saw, you know, Mark Zuckerberg, and it's like, yeah, this new thing, you know, tech startups. It's like, what is this? I thought I had a tech startup. I was faking it. You know, I had a blog. That's not a tech startup. So I was like, man, I want to get into the tech industry. So I went to the library. And I started to just look at all these different interviews from different tech entrepreneurs. And then eventually I started to learn how to code. I didn't have much money, so I just used Google to Google up some lessons on programming. And then eventually I learned enough to carry a conversation with an engineer or a developer. I went online, I searched on Craigslist, and I found that there was an internship for a startup that was based in Montclair, New Jersey, called bubbleon.com. And they were co-located between Montclair and New York City. And they were looking for a college intern. I didn't have a college degree, but I felt like, you know, I was good enough, you know? So I went to apply, and I did my homework on them, and I went to apply, and when it came for the meeting, and we all sat down together, and they said, why should we hire you as an intern? I said, well, I looked up your traffic stats, and I have 300% more traffic than you. I don't have a college degree, but I have 300% more traffic than you. So they took some time to think about that. I thought it was an instant decision, but they took some time to think about that. And then eventually I got the call like, hey, yeah, come on in as an intern. We'll test you out. So they didn't really quite trust me yet. They hired somebody else with me to see like who's gonna work out the best. So after about a month of interning, they hired me as a full-time business development associate. And so that was my way into the tech industry. That's how I hacked my way in, by just doing something that I loved, you know, created credibility with that thing that I loved, and then leveraged it and to get into where I wanted to be. And so that's how I started my journey, the very beginning, into tech entrepreneurship. Now, unfortunately, like 80% of other startups, Bubbleon failed. Probably 90% today. And I had this idea, though. You know, I was still stuck on video games. But I had this idea for an app called Plaid, P-L-A-Y-D. I sketched it out. It was really good. It was almost like Foursquare for video games. You scan the back of a box, and it can, you know, upload all your data, share with your friends, things of that nature. It was very early stage. And I pitched it to one of the investors for that startup. He liked it so much that he invested $100,000 into it. In hindsight, maybe that wasn't such a good idea. But I was just working at Kmart 4 months ago. So I didn't know no better. I was just a kid. I'm like, I'm ready to go. I thought I was doing something. I actually applied for an accelerator in Silicon Valley. And, you know, long story short, they called me in and said, hey, look, we accept you. And so right after I got the money for an investment in my company, about 2 months later, I was flying to live in Mountain View, California, which is Silicon Valley. And so I always tell people, like, 1 year I was working at Kmart, the next year I was working at Google. That's literally the truth. And when I flew over there, I had no idea what I was doing, neither did anybody. And so what they had us do on the first day when we were there, they had everybody pitch. And the part that I left out was that CNN documented this entire journey on a documentary called CNN Black in America, Silicon Valley. And so they followed me from when I was in Jersey all the way up to the time when I left Silicon Valley. And so you can see a lot of that. You can see me at Google pitching, sweating bullets, embarrassing myself on television in front of a million people, but it's all good. And I learned a lot from that experience. You know, we spent some time with mentors from Facebook, Google, Microsoft, a lot of the different startups that are in Silicon Valley. And I had the option to stay in Silicon Valley. But I didn't opt to stay. I felt like I wanted to come back home. I felt like there was a lot more to do at home, especially since we're so close to New York City. I felt like there were more opportunities back home. And so I flew back home, and I'll never forget it. When I got picked up from the airport, you know, my mother picked me up, and she drove through, you know, where we used to live, through the old neighborhoods. I'm born and raised in Newark, by the way. And it was just almost like a sad picture for me. Like, you know, I came from a sunny California, and the day I came back, it was cloudy outside, raining, very depressing. And my brother even said, why you have flip-flops on? And so it was just a contrast between day and night. And I did some research, and I started to feel, I was like, what's going on in Newark as far as the tech scene is concerned? What's going on in Newark when it comes to tech? I started doing some research. There wasn't even a tech meetup. The only thing that was really kind of close to tech was the incubator that NJIT was hosting. But NJIT's incubator has wet labs. So it's not just software. Like, people are in there developing new types of chemicals. And so, you know, it's not even really like the culture I just came from. And so I just decided to start the first tech meetup in Newark. I said, okay, if there's not a tech community here, I feel like I can start it. And so I started a meetup called Brick City Tech, which Mark briefly talked about. And the first meeting, maybe about 3 people showed up. The second meeting, maybe about 5 people showed up. The third meeting, maybe about 10. But right now we have like all together close to 3,000 members. And so it was just like really step by step to get that community brewing. But it was something about the Newark community that I felt really married to. Newark is the largest city in New Jersey. And so for it to not have any kind of tech presence whatsoever was, especially being 20 minutes from New York City, didn't make sense to me. And so I started it up. Now, shortly after coming back, I started to realize all the different issues that was happening in the community, but at the same time, my startup had launched. I launched my startup Plaid. We grew to 30,000 active users in 3 months. Unfortunately, my largest competitor at the time was a corporation called GameStop. Now, I'm not sure if anybody familiar with GameStop, but GameStop didn't like me because I had an app that encouraged people to buy games brand new. GameStop makes $2 billion a year off of used game sales, secondhand sales. So if you was to buy a game new from GameStop, you buy it for $60. You take it back to GameStop, they'll buy it back from you for $20. They'll put it back on the shelf and sell it for $50. And so when they resell the games, the publishers get no piece of that. And so they made $2 billion a year doing this. And so my app was a loyalty system that kind of encouraged and rewarded gamers for buying games brand new, even rewarding them with DLC content and things of that sort. My first big publisher partner was a company called THQ. And the two games we were supposed to launch with were WWE and a game called Saints Row. And so these were pretty big games. These are, you know, very well known culturally in their respective niches. And so I was very excited. You know, WWE sells over a million copies every release. A week before the game goes out, THQ claims bankruptcy. And there goes my startup. And that's when I learned I should never put all my eggs in one basket. But it was okay. You know, I wanted to do a pivot, but then I decided against the pivot because the investor that I had scared away every other investor. And that's when I learned my next lesson: never take dumb money. Now, there's a difference between smart money and dumb money, right? So smart money is when you take money from someone who is in your domain, who has some domain experience in what you're building. Dumb money is when you take money just from anybody who has a lot of money, whether or not they understand what you're building or not, meaning that the only value that they bring to your company is dollars and nothing else. Now, there are some people who can get away with that, but 9 times out of 10, it doesn't work. Because if they have no value outside of money, then you're bound to fail. And that's what happened with me. And so I started a company called The Fat Startup. Because anybody familiar with Lean Startup methodology? So Lean Startup is a methodology, for those who aren't familiar with it, Lean Startup methodology is basically a 3-step methodology. I'll break it down very simple, where you build, you measure, and you learn. And you do that cycle over and over again until you reach product market fit for what your startup is. And so what I didn't like about Lean Startup was that it encouraged failure, right? Now, there's nothing wrong with failure. I encourage it too. But I'm from Newark. And a lot of people from my neighborhood can't afford to fail continuously. You know, and that was the message that I got from Lean. And I was like, what if I could flip that in a different way and teach some startup lessons that can, I would say, more vibrate more towards this community. And so we created the Fast Startup. From that particular company, we launched maybe about 15 events in New York, all sold out. We partnered with tons of startups. Some of the guest speakers that we had at our lectures were people like Ben Horowitz, Gary Vaynerchuk, Alexis Ohanian is the co-founder of Reddit. The list goes on and on. And then we launched a tech conference called Tech 808, which we did in four cities, DC, Oakland, Atlanta, and New York City twice. We partnered with AT&T, PayPal, and NYU to throw this big national conference. And what I learned from that experience is that there really isn't a pipeline problem in tech, because we sold out every single time. You know, and that's what they like to say, that a lot of people of color aren't interested in technology. But that wasn't the case. You can go on YouTube right now, search Tech 808, and you can look at every single one of our lectures, every single one of our conferences, every single one of the speakers, and you can see that that's just not true. And so I learned a lot of lessons from that. And what I learned, that a lot of black entrepreneurs, a lot of young entrepreneurs of color, they lacked a lot of personal development. And so when I wrapped up the Fast Startup towards the end of last year, I decided to do a book series called Don't Dumb Down Your Greatness, and that's pretty much what the book is called. Now, I give the book away for free to you guys as a PDF, so if you were to go to that URL and put your email in, you'll get it. Unfortunately, I sold out. That's not an unfortunate thing, but I sold out. and it was a great experience. I've been traveling the country for like the last, I would say, a year, going to places like Mississippi, going to places like Memphis, going to places that normally, you know, tech entrepreneurship isn't promoted, and showing young people that you can do entrepreneurship your way. Some of the lessons that the book teaches is things on failure, how to fail the right way, how to goal set the right way, how to deal with criticism, and especially how to deal with self-doubt. And I think that self-doubt is the largest cancer to tech entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship in general, to any community, but especially young people of color. That's what I've noticed from my experience. And so today, what I've been blessed to be able to do is spend a lot of time at Newark Venture Partners. I started as the entrepreneur residence at Newark Venture Partners, top of this year. And a lot of what I've been doing is getting the community involved, doing events, doing lectures. Like tomorrow, we have business development 101. You know, a lot of people don't understand what business development is. And so we don't just have anybody come. We have the VP of business development of WeWork coming to speak and coming to give this workshop. So my goal is to get people who wouldn't normally be in front of these audiences and put them in front of these audiences, because I think that's what matters. And so that's my mission, to build that out. I kind of gave you guys the Cliff Notes version of my story. I hope it was entertaining, but thank you so much. And if you want the book, definitely just go to anthonyfrazier.com/FDU. Definitely. There you go. Thank you.
Before we join, I want to mention, it's wonderful to see Anthony Frazier speak. When you get to see him speak at some of these events closer to Newark, the kids around him, they're begging him for an autograph. It's pretty awesome to see. So he's really respected all over New Jersey. So.
I don't know about all that. This is a joke. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so one thing I like to do is, especially with Tech 808, we had a very diverse speaker lineup, but for the most part, it was a lot of people of color who was very successful in tech, and I'll tell you why. It wasn't necessarily not to be super diverse, it was because we needed to plant the idea, right? Like, if I can just see myself, you don't have to understand a word I'm saying. I could be up here talking a bunch of gibberish to a young person. But the fact that he can just look and say, oh, he's successful in technology? Maybe I can do that, right? And so it's about planting that idea in a young person's mind. So what I like to do is give them examples of people that are just like them, that's come from their situation or maybe even worse, and show them like, hey, you know, this person made it out. For instance, there's a young lady named Sheena Allen who's from Mississippi, from Jackson, Mississippi, wherever that is. And she has an app company with 4 million downloads. How she learned how to code? She never learned how to code. I asked her, I was like, how did you learn how to build your first app? She said she got Microsoft Word and started using the shapes. Then she got a developer off of a guru.com because she went to Google and typed, I need a developer. It was just that simple. Now she has an app company with several apps and almost 5 million downloads, 4 million right now, but going, you know, approaching 5 million. And so if somebody could see her and be like, wait, hold up. She's in the middle of nowhere. And she built this app company with millions of downloads. I can do that. You know, just continually providing examples like that, I think is important. And it can, the more he can see himself in the people who are becoming successful or getting accolades, the more he will be encouraged. That's what I believe. Cool.
Great to hear your story, so thank you for presenting. And I had a great question, that was a question I was going to ask. And building off that question, one of the things that you did was you took a very entrepreneurial route to success, and you probably have a lot of entrepreneurs, but that have also taken that type of route. But is there a place for people in companies like Google, for example, we're talking about the pipeline? Can you go to one of those companies and avoid the customer service rep position and elevate yourself there, or do you have to kind of take a different route?
Yes, you can. First thing I would tell you is to kind of study the type of positions that are available at these companies. You're in college? You go to this school? How old are you?
I'm 30.
Oh man, you look younger than me, man. We're the same age. So, so here's the thing, right? You don't necessarily need a college degree to get a job in the industry. Some of the most popular, you know, positions in tech are now being offered independently through schools like Flatiron School, through different online education courses, through a lot of New York. If you're in this area, New York City has a lot of independent schools. There's a company I know called 2020 Shift that basically does a course teaching people how to do product management and project management specifically for tech. And so I think if you're looking for a non-engineering role, there's plenty of ways to prepare for that. But if you're looking for an engineering role, then you gotta do what you gotta do. You gotta bunker down, you know, cut off the TV, no more cartoons, no Xbox, you know, and just go in, you know, and just learn, you know, a popular language, you know, whether that be Python or Ruby on Rails, or, you know, whatever it you feel like the position you want to go for requires you to learn. And so there's no easy route to get into engineering. I think that's the cold, hard truth. So if you are you an engineer? Okay, so you gotta switch over. Yeah, so you programming now?
No, but I'm in technology. I look at
Okay, so I mean, just study the roles that are available, right? And figure out how, a way to prepare yourself. You'd be surprised. I think you can get in, actually. I don't know if you've been trying or not, but yeah, we could talk about that. But I think you can get in. I think you're fairly, well positioned, to be honest with you. Yeah.
Of course, I feel like I've been asleep listening to this to you. It's like there's other startup activities we have on the universe. We're up in a little.
Yeah, you guys are in the corner, man.
How do we get more connected? Because it sounds like there's a lot more going on in New York.
There is. Yeah, I mean, well, we have to do a better job. I'm connected with NJIT. You know, NJIT is what I did most of my Brick City Tech startups, actually. I think right now, this is more of like a communication thing, just making sure that the people who are spreading the word in the EDC specifically, you say in the EDC, right?
Yeah. But then, don't get me wrong, they do a great job. They really do a great job. But it doesn't feel like, I mean, there was
a community.
That's
why I started Brick City Tech, yeah. That's exactly why I started. I think just really, you know, I think that's more of a problem that I can solve, right? Doing a better job to get in touch with the people at NJIT to make them more aware of what's going on from my point of view. And so I can do more, I could do better on that front. But at the same time, I don't think that anybody's gonna reach out to me and try to get it going. So I'll reach out to them and see if I can get you guys involved with the community. Definitely. Cool. Perfect. It's a wrap.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you.
So I'm the last guy in a parade of people introducing people. I do go to school here. I go every day because I get to be the provost of this campus. FDU has four campuses, just to make sure you all know that. There are two in New Jersey, one in Vancouver, and one in Roxton, Oxfordshire, England. And I invite you from the tech meetup to have your meetings on any of those campuses. One reason I enjoy going to school here every day is because I'm reminded every day when I'm here that the people who were able to build this beautiful building and these beautiful grounds were entrepreneurs, right? Cornelius Vanderbilt, who's looking at you all from one eye on that wall, he was the entrepreneur of entrepreneurs, right? Starting with a ferry service in the Raritan Bay around Staten Island and building an empire from there. He built a fortune that was so big, like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett put together, that it took five generations of profligate living to squander that fortune, huh? Which is great, because that's how we got the estate. But tonight, it's my great pleasure to introduce an alum of FDU, Gene Waddy, a visionary entrepreneur and the owner of DIVERSANT LLC, the nation's largest African-American-owned IT staffing and solutions firm. In many ways, DIVERSANT is a reflection of Gene's professional expertise, his personal drive, and his commitment to helping others. The company has enjoyed dramatic growth even during the economic downturn and has developed a reputation for excellence among the Fortune 500 companies. Gene's entrepreneurial journey is really an inspiration to all entrepreneurs here tonight who embrace the spirit of building an organization that has the potential to shape the future of society. Recently, Gene was named the 2013 Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year for New Jersey. Gene graduated from Fairleigh Dickinson University with a degree in mechanical engineering. He might urge you to switch over too. He graduated in 1992 and is already the recipient of FDU's most prestigious alumni award, the Pinnacle, to recognize the extraordinary contributions and accomplishments of our alumni. So it's my honor to welcome Gene back to our campus and to introduce him as this year's Richard M. Clarke Distinguished Entrepreneurial Lecturer. Gene?
Oh, thank you very much. It's wonderful to be back on the campus. Again, I'm Gene Waddy, CEO and owner of DIVERSANT LLC. We're an IT staffing firm based out of Red Bank, New Jersey. We are 12 years old in this past July. So I started the firm in 2005. And I've been in the IT staffing field 23 years. So when I started, I had a lot more hair. I was a lot thinner. I didn't need glasses. And I did not need these hearing aids that I have on right now. So time has flown by since I was able to grace the campus, the Metro campus, they call it now. When I was in school, it was called the Teaneck Hackensack campus. And so it's wonderful to be here again. Looking forward to talking to you guys tonight. And I want to kind of give you a little insight on my story and how I ended up, you know, being, you know, head of a $160 million business, which we built in 12 years. You know, I come from Neptune, New Jersey, Asbury Park. I'm the son of a blue-collar worker. My dad worked at the 3M company for 30 years to put me and my brothers and sisters through school. Three of the five went to Fairleigh Dickinson. We're all on the family plan, as they say, because we wanted to get that discount on the tuition. But Fairleigh Dickinson, I think, really prepared me for my journey as an entrepreneur. And I didn't really know it at the time. As you heard, I was an engineering major. I had a high tolerance for pain. I was a glutton for punishment, and I used to take 22 credits a semester, and I would ask myself every night, why am I doing this to myself? Why? Why am I doing this? It's so painful. And I remember a lot of my buddies, you know, that had different majors. They would be at the pub to 2 o'clock in the morning having a good time and just sailing through. And I, for a minute, thought about changing my major. So I went home and I said, Dad, I really want to change my major from engineering. I want to be a communications major. And he said, unless you're going to pay for it, you are going to stay an engineering major, and I did. And I graduated with a degree in engineering in 1991. And if any of you remember what was going on in 91, there was a recession going on. So when I got out of school, there weren't many engineering jobs, especially in manufacturing, that were domestic. A lot of the offshoring had begun. So many of the large manufacturing jobs were now moving offshore. And since I had no desire to move to Mexico, I had to make a pivot. As Brother Frazier said, sometimes you have to pivot in life. So I answered an ad in the paper. There I go, dating myself again, an ad in the paper. This was before monster.com and going online and doing all that. Every Sunday, I couldn't wait for the Star Ledger to come out, and I get my highlighter, and I just go through, you know, call and fax and all that stuff, very low tech. But I got a job in a PC repair warehouse and learned how to build PCs and servers from the ground up, printers as well. So I learned the business from the ground up. And that's what started the journey. And I realized that IT is such a vast, vast area, technology in general. And it started me on my career. You know, go back a second. While I was at Fairleigh Dickinson, I think one of the great lessons I learned was the importance of diversity and being around different types of people. So, because when I got out into the work world, everyone did not look like me. When I left home to go to college, I was in a dorm with people from South Africa. Well, this is during the apartheid era, by the way. People from Manchester, England. Folks whose parents had a, you know, dry cleaning business in Brooklyn. My other roommate was a tennis scholar from Lansdale, Pennsylvania. Right? So I've met all these different types of people. And when I got out into the real world, that's what hit you in the face right away. Everyone is not like you. So for those of you that are still in school, take advantage of that. This school is an awesome testing ground for these theories. Get to know other people. You know, I am a success in business because of my network. My wealth resides in my network. My ability to pick up a phone and call someone who I built a relationship with for 20, 25 years or more. So that's very, very important. I spoke a little bit about my first job in a PC warehouse, and compared to what my dad did for 32 years, that was a glamorous position. I said that my father worked at the 3M company. Let me just give you an understanding of what he did. So for those of you that are familiar with 3M, they make what? Does anybody know? Scotch tape. Well, Scotch tape is a plastic product, but it also has adhesives on it. And adhesives, for any of you that know anything about chemistry, are nasty chemicals. And my dad worked in hell on earth for 30 years to put us through school. And I'm going to tell you a little story about my motivation when I went to school and how I knew I had to be successful. My senior year in high school, straight A student, I'm sailing through. I had senioritis. I didn't want to do anything. I just wanted to hang out at the beach all summer. My dad decided, Gene, I got good news for you. I have landed you an internship at 3M. And I'm like, yes, internship. I'm on my way. And he said, you know, you're going to be an engineer. And I said, Pop, you know, I don't really know what engineers do. And I know that you don't know what engineers do. He said, boy, first of all, engineers work the day shift, and they wear suits and ties, and they have clean hands. That's all you need to know. So I'm thinking, okay, I'm on my way. So one night, knock on the door, let's go, get up. So what's going on, Pop? So we're going to go to work. You're coming with me. And I'm looking at the clock, and I'm like, well, I was just about to go out with my boys. It's 9:30, 10 o'clock. And my dad was old school. The shift started at 12, but I had to kind of find that they had to be there like an hour and a half early just to get ready, get his suit on, have his, you know, lunch and talk to his people. Being late was not acceptable. So I'm thinking, it's night shift. It can't be any engineering going on at 12 o'clock at night. But he said, well, no, you know, there are people there. It's a 24-hour operation. So I go there, and first night, he sits, you know, the foreman comes up, introduces himself to me, and he says, you know, sit right here. We got a job for you. And on this, on my right, was boxes stacked up to the ceiling of tape, rolls of Scotch tape. There was a machine here in the middle, and there was a conveyor belt over here with empty boxes. My job was to take, if anybody knows anything about Scotch tape, it's on a cardboard core. Well, when you roll the tape, sometimes there's a bubble on that, and it doesn't look, you know, very pleasing. It gets rejected. My job was to take a roll of tape, take it out, put it on this spindle, thread it over to another empty core, put my foot down on this actuator, spins the tape onto a new core, take it, put it in the box. And I did that all summer long. I was falling asleep. I thought I was going to kill myself, falling into the machine, you know, drinking coffee by the gallon, trying to stay awake. And I was beyond angry with my dad. I was like, why would this man do this to me? Now, I was in the union. I was making a whopping $335 a week. So I had plenty of money, 18-year-old kid in 1986. So I'm thinking, this is great. I'm living large. The problem was, because I was working the night shift, I slept all day and didn't get to spend any money anyway. So by the end of the summer, I had a ton of money, bought a little piece of car, which lasted me my whole college career. But I was upset. And last day of work before I went to school, my dad said, he said, look, you know, I know you're mad at me. And I know you don't really understand why I did this. But if you go up to that school and you don't do what you're supposed to do, and you even think that you're going to come back here and sponge off with your mother and I, you are sadly mistaken. This is the best you could hope for. Scared me to death because there was no way on God's green earth I was going to work with him for another 30 years. So I'm thinking, fairly, here I come. And I threw everything I had at engineering, right? But I'm a straight-A student. I had a little swagger on. I'm thinking, how hard could it be? I was used to not even really studying, really, and still getting straight A's. And then calculus hit me, and thermo hit me, and, you know, all these different courses just hit me. And I realized something. I wasn't as smart as I thought I was. So I had to learn how to learn. I had to form study groups. I had to meet and collaborate with other people. And these people were from different backgrounds, all around the world. And that's when I understood that no man really, it's true, no man is an island. If you're going to be successful, you have to have other people around you. And I use that lesson today in my business, right? I am good at certain things. I'm really good at business development, networking, building relationships. There are other people that are really good at spreadsheets and legal and all the other stuff that it takes to run a business. The key to being a good CEO is to understand your strengths and match them up to the strengths of other people and be shameless about bringing the best talent you can and get them on the bus. That's what I do day in and day out. I'm shameless about talent. That's the key to the whole game. So fast forward, I'm working. I started off as a PC repair person, worked my way up, and got into the IT staffing end of the business. And I worked for a company called Interim Technology, which was a staffing firm. But their staffing was IT related, so I learned the IT staffing business on their dime for about 9 years. Company fell on hard times. I got downsized. The best thing that ever happened to me in my life was getting downsized. Now, it didn't feel that way at the time. When it happened, I wasn't very happy about it because, I'm solidly middle management and doing quite well, and had no thoughts of starting my own business. And I want to say that in the spirit of humility and transparency. Many entrepreneurs talk about, I knew when I was 7 years old that I wanted to form my own company and do all these great things. That is not the case with me. I was raised, again, blue collar. My dad worked 32 years in one place. That's what he wanted for me. And that's what I thought I was going to do. You know, I wanted to work for J&J or Merck, and in those days, or AT&T. Those people worked at that company for 35 years. That's what I wanted. But there was a shift in the economy, and those jobs really don't exist anymore. People in my generation are younger. You work somewhere 4 or 5 years, that's enough. So things have changed. But when I got downsized, it forced me to rely on myself and take a minute, take a time out, and decide, what do you really want to do? You can go back and work for a competitor, because you're good at what you do. You've learned the IT staffing and solutions business. You can always go work for somebody else. But what I did not like about working for a large corporation is that you were not necessarily close to the decision making, right? You were a number. You were one of thousands of employees. You had no control over your own destiny. So I decided, before I go back and work for someone else, I'm going to take a chance on me. I know this IT staffing stuff cold. I've applied my engineering discipline to this, and I really understood the business. And I had a lot of relationships, again, because I worked almost 10 years in the same industry. And I came home from work, and I told my wife, I said, honey, guess what happened to me today? I got laid off. She's looking at me like, okay, what else is coming? I know there's another part of the story. I said, I'm gonna start my own IT staffing company, and she thought I was insane. She actually started to cry because she's pregnant. I was closing on a house, and I had never run a business before. And oh, by the way, I had a modest severance. So there's never a right time to start your own business, folks. But being laid off forced me to think for myself. So I ended up networking, talking to other people, former colleagues, other folks that I knew in the business world, And I had an idea. You know, the first idea I had was to not listen to negative people. Okay, that's the first thing. I wanted to start to surround myself with positive-minded people who were already successful, and especially in my field. And one thing I've learned about successful people, they love to talk about themselves, and myself included. And then, you know, LinkedIn and all these different tools that people have today, they're so powerful. You can literally connect to the CEO of, name a company, a New Jersey company, a regional company that's a $100 million firm or a $50 million firm, and say, hey, I'm Gene Waddy. You know, I've been following your career for a while. Like, hey, I'm local. I'm in your neck of the woods. Do you have 5 minutes for a cup of coffee? Really want to get your insight on boom, boom, boom. It's just that simple. And then after that, it's about numbers. The more you reach out, the higher your chances of getting success. So I started to talk to people. I said, Gene, look, you want to go into IT staffing? Well, you definitely need to start a minority-owned business, because there are not enough minority-owned businesses, especially in the staffing industry, that can scale. Okay? You have an engineering background, you understand business, you're disciplined, you're driven. What we got to do now is find you some financing, because you have an idea. You want to start an IT staffing firm that's minority-owned, that can scale, and that can support the needs of the Fortune 500, whom I've been working for 10 years. So I know what they need. I know what they buy. So my business plan, I could put on the back of a napkin. It's very simple. There were no firms like DIVERSANT, even today, right? We're a $160 million run rate firm. There are maybe two or three black-owned firms my size or bigger, right? That's nationally, folks, right? So there's a lot of work to be done when it comes to diverse businesses, and I'm going to touch on that a little bit. But again, the fact that door was wide open. I'm not a genius. I just saw something, and I figured I was going to act on it. I met my business partner who had just sold a piece of his business. He was in the IT staffing business. We came together, and DIVERSANT was founded in 2005. And we went from zero to today, $160 million run rate. We've got 10 offices. I've got 150 employees. We've got 1,200 consultants on billing. Our clients are Verizon, Merck, Comcast, ADP, Wells Fargo. You know, the list goes on and on. We are number 23 on the Black Enterprises list of 100 top companies. You know, Pinnacle Award winner from Fairleigh Dickinson, which is, I'm very proud of. Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year, and all that's fantastic. But what gives me the most pride as an entrepreneur, what really makes me get up every morning and run, is not the money or the accolades. It's the fact that you can leverage your business as a platform to do good. Because, folks, when you go home to glory, wherever that might be for you, you go with nothing. You come into the world with nothing, and you leave with nothing. So senior entrepreneur, a very wealthy entrepreneur that I know and respect, said this to me. He said, Gene, you should plan to die empty. Think about that. Die empty. All the blessings and all the things that you've achieved in your life, no matter how you got them, you didn't do them on your own. You're standing on the shoulders of someone else. It could be your parents, your grandparents, people that came before you. Regardless of your race, creed, color, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the fact that it's a continuum, right? So you have to pay that back. So that's why, like what Brother Frazier was talking about the work he's doing in Newark, you know? You've got to take your platform and make that your ministry. And what I do is I go back and I mentor a lot of minority youth and non-minority youth, other business owners around the country. I make time, I fly, I do conference calls, speaking engagements. I'm on the board of several charter schools. I'm trying to, as the good comes to me, I'm trying to give it away as fast as I can. That's the secret to my success. I try to give it away as fast as I can, and it keeps coming back, and it's multiplying, and I can't even stop it now. And I don't want to, because I can do so much with this platform that I've been given. So how many people, first of all, I want to see, I know there are some students in the room. How many students do we have? Anybody? Students? One, two. Okay. for you folks, I'll give you a little advice. Now, you're in school, right? Some undergrad or maybe grad, and you're probably in your 20s, some of you, maybe, you know, and you think, I got plenty of time to figure this stuff out. No, you don't. No, you don't. Time is the most precious commodity you are given in life. Because if you squander it, you can't get it back. And as successful, quote unquote, as people say I am, I stress and I beat myself up about wasted time. Because I got out of school, I was 21, 22 years old. I didn't hit my stride until I was almost 30. And I'm still upset about that. So I think, man, what could I have done with that lost decade? And it's not like I was sitting around at home, but I was working this job, that job, trying to figure it out. And listen, you learn a lot more from your failures than your successes. I get that. But still, time. I think about it all the time. I think about it. I mean, when I went to Fairleigh Dickinson, I was on the Teaneck Hackensack campus, and I think I only came to Madison once, maybe twice. I never went to Roxton. I never visited, they even had a campus in the West Indies at one point. The marine biology, never went, right? So for all you folks that are in undergrad, first of all, I applaud you. Folks that are still matriculated that are here, I applaud you. You know why? Because it's a weekday night and you are out networking. You're talking to other folks, you're connecting, you're still listening to me, right? You're dealing with a lecturer. That's what it's all about. That's going to put you head and shoulders above your colleagues that are hitting the bar right now. And you may not understand this now, but there's a four. No, 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 that does not mean now, by the way. The meetup guy from Morris is like, what? There's a time and a place for everything. And plus, you're more my age. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to them. See? Right? Because Lord knows I'm a fraternity guy. I'm an alpha. I did my fair share of partying when I was in school. Let's not kid. No, let's not, you know, I'm not here to kind of snow job anybody. But I applaud you guys for being here because I didn't do enough of that. Connecting with your professors after hours, getting to know your administration, truly understanding where the university is going. Because folks, I'm going to tell you something. When you get out of school, you know next to nothing about business, the real world. I'm not saying that you don't have a degree. I'm not saying that you don't have, you know, a 4.0 GPA. I'm not saying that. But I'm a business owner. I'm a job creator. I hire hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. Matter of fact, we're going to hire 75 college grads next year. So I know when you come out of these hallowed halls, you don't know everything, right? But what I will tell you is what's going to get you ahead and what's got me ahead. First thing is grit. Grit. G-R-I-T. Write it down. Grit is what separates you from your competition. You get knocked down, you get back up. So you have self-doubt, you overcome it. Somebody tells you you can't, you take that anger and that frustration and you turn it around into something positive. I am not the smartest guy in the room, but I will outwork just about anybody. That's their blue-collar background. Use what you have to get ahead, right? Do you know who's really successful in the entrepreneurial world? People with a chip on their shoulder. Or even the business world, got a little something to prove. Wasn't handed everything in life. As a matter of fact, when I do interviews and I hire people, one of the first things I do, especially college grads, what's your dad do? What's your mom do? Where'd you grow up? What was your first job? If you tell me your dad was a vascular surgeon and you got a $20,000 handbag on, nope, that's not what I'm looking for. It's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for somebody that's looking for that opportunity that you spoke about. Somebody that's like, you know what? I know I can do it, and I'm willing to prove it. I'm willing to put the hours in, I'm gonna come in early, I'm gonna stay late, I'm gonna listen, and I'm gonna work my butt off. And those are the people we're looking for. So hold on to that. That's very important. I see it all the time. People that are handed things in life don't sometimes don't appreciate it. right? They don't appreciate it. You know, I've got a lot of work left to do ahead of me. I want to double the size of the company in the next 5 years. I want to become an investor for other minority businesses. You know, I want to do a lot more philanthropic work. You know, there's a lot to do. There's a lot to do. And I think it's important as a business owner to keep your feet on the ground, because you are a role model to others, even when you don't want to be. That's another thing they don't tell you about in business school. If you're at a certain level of success, your life changes, right? I grew up in Neptune, New Jersey. I was born in the Bronx. And I, like most of us, I have some friends who may not be doing all exactly the right things all the time. Or I have some family members that are not really exercising the best judgment all the time. We all have people in our lives like this. But when you are in the business world and you reach a certain level of success, you have to change for the benefit of your business, but also for the benefit of the community, right? That means there are certain places I cannot be, if you know what I mean. There are certain things that I can no longer do. Why? Because I'm being followed on Twitter and on Facebook and in the media, right? And I try to give that as a thought for those of you that want to be in business. You're a job creator, which means more than likely you're doing things in the community. You want to be a force for good. You want to do well and do good at the same time, right? It's an added weight that an entrepreneur has to carry around with them. Because if you decide to make an ill-informed decision, you could hurt your employees. You could ruin client relationships. I've got 1,200 consultants out there that depend on me and my team to make those decisions and make the right ones. And it doesn't end. The weekends, nights, whether you feel bad, I have a wicked cold. But I made a commitment to be here, and I'm glad that I am. It never ends. When you own your own business, it is a 24/7 commitment. How many of you here are thinking about starting your own business or already have your own business? Oh, well, welcome. Welcome to the world of the bottomless cup of coffee, headaches, sleepless nights, 5 o'clock flights to nowhere, missing birthdays, right? You know, maybe you got a sick child, and you got to go because the CIO of X company says, I got an opportunity for you. That's the side of the entrepreneurial lifestyle that people don't always understand, right? And I'm here to tell you my truth. It ain't always glorious. It's not. It's not always fun. Not always fun, you know? But when it's good, it's real good, though. I don't want to paint the wrong picture. You know, it is wonderful to be able to help others find jobs, because that's what I do all day. That's what my company does. We're a staffing company, so I get to find people jobs. It's wonderful to be able to go back to Clifford Scott, you know, High School in East Orange, or go to the Marion P. Thomas School in Newark and speak to the kids and show them. It's like what Tony said. If you show these kids, especially in our inner cities, if you show them a better way, when I mean show them, I don't mean email your way there. You got to go. You got to go and show them. No, no. There is a place for you. You know, there is a huge disparity when it comes to STEM education, or STEAM, right? Because now art is part of it, and our inner cities. But there's a talent pool there. There's a rich vein of talent here, but it requires a lot of work to get to it. The folks that I went to school with, they went to Cornell and Wharton and the University of Pennsylvania, diverse or not, don't need your help. The line to hire them is around the block. The talent is that student that they're smart, but they just need somebody to break through and help them, show them the way. Could be someone who's, you said, self-doubt. That's a cancer. Self-doubt. before you've even applied, you've talked yourself out of it. And one of my passions is to combat that phenomenon by going to the schools and using my quote-unquote position, because I don't take any of this stuff too seriously. I'm a humble guy. I'm a humble guy from Neptune, New Jersey. But while I'm here and while I have this opportunity, I'm going to use it. Going back to these schools and telling these kids, I sat right where you are sitting. And I remember people would come to the school and talk to us. They would talk at us, or over us, and they wouldn't come back. They only came once. So you would just lose everything they said, right? We do it differently. And when I say we, I mean me and my team. This is part of working for DIVERSANT. You all have to be part of this culture or you're not going to last here. Because I want to be a $300 million company, but I also want to sleep at night. I want to know that we did good in the community that we serve. And what's wonderful about it, folks, it also aligns with the value system of most of our clients, right? Whether all the companies I named earlier, they all have diversity initiatives, they all have community outreach, they all want to have more workforce diversity. So my firm, DIVERSANT, lives right there in the middle. IT staffing, talent acquisition, workforce diversity, supply diversity, community outreach, and we're right there in the middle. That's the niche. That's the vision that I had years and years ago, and it's coming to fruition. Folks always ask me, Gene, what's next, for DIVERSANT? When somebody asks me that, I always say, why? Are you trying to buy us? Because it's for sale anytime. If you got a check on you, I'm ready to go. But in all seriousness, we just want to grow a great company. We're a good company on our way to being great. I want to double the size of the firm. We're going to expand into other cities. We have 10 offices. I want to see what we can do next year about adding two or three. We're going to go into other verticals. Right now, we're heavily weighted in banking and insurance. We're doing more in energy and telecom and biotech. So there's a lot out there. The IT staffing market in the United States is a $20 billion marketplace. So there's plenty of upside for DIVERSANT. But I'm here today. Hey, I want to say thank you to the university. Thank you to Timur and all of his people and Rick. And I had a wonderful dinner with President Capuano earlier as well to say thank you for inviting me to come back and talk to you. And talk to the folks today. And what I want to do is, after saying thank you, I want to be able to kind of do a Q&A kind of thing, because I think that's where you learn the most. And I'm not going to do it from up here. So whoever has that mic, I'm going to mill around a little bit, and I'll just come down. But thank you for listening, and now we'll do a Q&A. Mm-hmm.
I wanted to thank both Anthony and Gene for being here, sharing their insightful advice and their experience with all of you. And Gene, I would like to invite you up to the stage. On behalf of the Institute, I would like to present you with the Distinguished Entrepreneurial, I'm sorry, the Richard M. Clarke Distinguished Entrepreneurial Lecture for your achievements as an entrepreneur and growing DIVERSANT over the years. Congratulations.
Thank you.